Okay, I'm with Maria Eagles, who's been Shadow Transport Secretary for about 6 months now, so you must have got used to the job a bit.
Well, it's a bit less than that, but it seems like years in some ways. I'm getting into it and I enjoy it. It's an aspect of life that touches everybody, matters to everybody. And so it's exciting for me to be doing
it. Absolutely, and you did do transport a long time ago in opposition, about 20 years ago, so you know a bit about it.
It was a long time ago, Christine, yes, and so I have a little bit of background in transport, and that's, I think, will be a good thing.
How do you differentiate yourself from Tory party policy? Because some of the things, clearly, they've done have been in line with your policy, actually, like, say, on rail investment.
Yeah, well, some of what they've done is carrying on our policy, and obviously we think that's good. We're a responsible opposition, so where we agree, we'll say so. But some of what they're doing, we don't agree with. Even on rail investment, they're pushing a lot of it into the future, into future spending reviews. And so we have to keep an eye, as the opposition should, on what they're doing and be constructively critical, and we're doing that.
So, where are the areas you're differentiating yourself on policy? Have you come up particular bits you're really opposed to what they're doing?
Yes, well, for example, their fare increases, shifting the burden from very much onto the user by changing to RPI plus 3. I mean, over the spending review period, that's a 30% fare increase if you look at the OBR's figures on inflation, likely inflation. That is very difficult for hard-pressed commuters trying to get to work at the same time as their wages are being squeezed, many of them losing their child benefit. And even the government have admitted that these fare rises and other measures will price people off the railways. Now, that's not going to help improve our transport system or create sustainability in transport.
But, you know, we all know we're living at times of austerity. There have to be cuts. Would you not have done a similar thing? As a Labour government?
Well, we accepted the need to reduce the deficit, and we have an argument with the government about how far and how fast they're going. We wouldn't have done it in the way in which they are. And we would have, for example, still had a more taxes on say, the banks. So we would have had more money to spend on infrastructure investment. This is about the future of the country, and if you cut things back too much, then obviously you're undermining a capacity to grow in the future. And growth, supporting jobs and growth, is a clear way of reducing the deficit and getting us out of the recession. And just cutting the deficit too far and too fast isn't necessarily going to achieve that.
What do you think the impact of the cuts is going to be on transport? I mean, do you think it's going to be hit particularly badly? In which areas are going to be hit badly?
Well, transport actually did badly in the CSR settlement. I mean, Philip Hammond likes to say he did brilliantly well, but in fact we're seeing a 15% cut in transport spending. The department was put down as a loser by the IFS in its analysis. And the consequence of this is we're seeing cuts not only in rail investment and things being pushed to the right and delayed, but we're also seeing particularly hard hit local transport arrangements. So, for example, what's happening to buses locally, partly because of the cut in local transport grants, but also because of that combined with cuts to local authority spending, are really horrific. It's not just the cut in bus service operators grant. It's removal of funds which used to be spent on local transport, used to be spent supporting buses, which now are not going to be. And we've got to remember, 80% of people who use public transport use buses. Job seekers, most of them do not have cars. They do not have access to their own transport. So if the bus is gone, then how can they get to a job or a job interview? The potential here for causing a lot of damage in local communities is really quite high, and that's without the damage that can be done to creating a better, more integrated and sustainable transport system locally. At the end of the day, that's where it has to be done.
So you're going to try and create a distinctive transport policy. You're currently reviewing your policies, is that right?
Yes.
You've got a new agenda.
Yes. We're about to start a fundamental review of all of our policies, which I'll be launching sometime next month. Can't give you the exact date today, but it'll be sometime in March. And it's going to be very outward looking. It's going to be inviting comments and evidence and suggestions from the very many stakeholders that there are in transport, the very many people around the country who are interested in transport policy. Sustainability is going to be a key part of it, and I hope that a result of it will be that we will have a transport policy fit for not only the next general election, but fit for making our transport system much, much better in future and more sustainable.
Okay, well, we look forward to hearing from you. Thank you very much, Maria Eagles.